Amen, amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. We've been called to rejoice and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet have stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. Good morning, Turner's Chapel, African Methodist Episcopal Church, and welcome to our virtual worship experience. To our family and friends, we welcome you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We welcome you in the name of the resurrected Lord Jesus the Christ. At this time, we're going to enter and begin our worship service with the doxology, Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
There is power.
deliver, power to save, power to transform, power to renew in the precious blood of the Lamb. Amen. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the gift of this day. We thank you for all that you've done, are doing, and promised to do in and through and around our lives. God, for waking us up this morning, we say thank you. For giving us a reasonable portion of our health and our strength, we say thank you. For clothing us in our right minds, dear God, we say thank you. God, we glorify your holy and righteous name, because from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, your name is worthy to be praised. God, you thought it not robbery to allow the blood to still run warm in our veins. You thought it not robbery to allow us to inhale and exhale. And for that, God, we say thank you. We bless your name, God, because of who you are, because of what you've done, and because of what you promised to do. We ask, dear God, to forgive us of shortcomings, sins, wrongs, things done and left undone that have been unpleasing in your sight. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Savior. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us of all that is past, and grant that we might ever hereafter serve you and please you in the fullness of life. God, we ask right now that you would inhabit this worship experience. Holy Spirit, have thine own way. Touch us where we need to be touched. Heal us where we need to be healed. Renew us where we need to be renewed. Empower us where we need to be empowered. Strengthen us where we are weak. Encourage us where we are without hope. And by your power and your grace, that you would receive all the glory, all the honor, and the praise, that it would be for our good and for your glory. Go now, dear God, through each and every home, each and every car, each and every job, wherever your people are, make your presence known. Use us in this worship experience to be both proclaimers and activators of your mission and your ministry. It's in the mighty and matchless name of Christ Jesus we do pray. Amen and amen.
I will trust you.
Our hymn this morning will be coming from page 513. Time is filled with swift transition. Not on earth unmoved can stay. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Again, that is Acts, the fourth chapter, verses 32 through 37. And it reads, "Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership over any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned land and houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. There was a Levite, a native of Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field that belonged to him, then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. The word of God for us, the people of God, thanks be unto God. From all that dwells below the skies, let thy Creator's praise arise. From YouTube, we ask that you would go ahead and subscribe to our page so that you can be up to date as far as what's going on here at Turner's Chapel AME Church in High Point, North Carolina. We've now entered into that part of the service where we can give back unto the Lord and to the ministry a portion of what God has so richly and bountifully blessed us with. God has been good to us. Even in the midst of this pandemic, God has kept us. Even in the midst of all the things that are going on in the world, God has sustained us. Even in the midst of hurt, sorrow, and shame, God has healed us and renewed our strength. And so we simply ask that we give back unto the Lord and the church, the house of God, a portion of that which God has blessed us with. So you can go over to our Givelify and look up Turner's Chapel, AME Church in High Point, and designate your funds to go to the ministry here by any amount, whatever you feel like blessing the Lord our God and the ministry here at in High Point with. You can also go to Cash App and type in $ Turner's Chapel AME and find us with our logo and give to the ministry there. Whatever means you choose to give, we bless God for you and for the act of giving. At this time, we'll have a little bit of giving music, and we'll be back to consecrate the offering.
Thank you.
into your lap a hundredfold of that which you have blessed the Lord our God with. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Freshness to remind you of where we're coming from. Acts, the 4th chapter, verses 32 through 37. Acts, the 4th chapter, verses 32 through 37. And it reads, "Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands and houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. There was a Levite, a native of Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field that belonged to him, then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. The word of God for us, the people of God, thanks be unto God. And if a servant must have a title, let this be it. Everybody eats. Everybody eats. Let us pray. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars with their courses above. Join in.
Left without grace is thy faithfulness. When you could have gone
find the glory, God. Because every time we look around, every time we look back, every time we think back, God, you have provided for us. You have provided for us. You have provided for us. God, throughout this annual conference, you provided. Throughout this year, God, up until this very day and time, you have provided for us. And for it all, God, we say thank you. God, we bless your name. We glorify your name. We magnify your name because you're worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Now, Lord, may the words of our mouths and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and redeemer. And the people of God said amen, amen, and amen. Everybody eats. Everybody eats. On this second Sunday of Easter, we recognize the fact and the notion that the grave, death, and violence do not in fact have the final say. While they seemingly have power in our everyday life, both domestically and internationally, and in just this week alone with those that we have lost, death, the grave, and violence do not reign supreme. Not only this, but the same power that rose Jesus from the dead is the same power we ourselves have access to. It's not magic, it's not a strategy, but rather it is the living power of the Almighty God. Jesus' death on the cross and subsequent resurrection should remind us each and every day that what looks like, what seems like, what even feels final is never the end of the story. Jesus' resurrection is so much more than simply about our personal and spiritual salvation. It is much more than just someone having power over the living and the dead. It is about a restructuring of how we view life, how we view our practices, how we view our way of life, and how we view our economy. Too often, we have left this out of our conversation of faith and salvation. Now, this is not a message on the prosperity gospel, the version that says God wants to bless you with material things, cars, money, homes, the finer things in life. This is not a message that says if you're broke, you can't be blessed. If you're poor, you can't be blessed. Rather, this is a message that says God intends for us as believers to create an economy, a society wherein none go lacking. One wherein everyone has what they need to survive and thrive, becoming the people and the world God desires us to be. For far too long, those making the rules of how society should run have used theology and the Bible to keep poor people poor. They often refer to Jesus' own words when they say, "The poor you will have with you always," as if that releases them from the duty to eradicate poverty. But this morning, I've just stopped by to inform some and remind others that that's not what Jesus was getting at. Jesus fought very much so for a world wherein those deemed outcast by their physical or economic condition would be included. Jesus died because his ministry threatened not only the political power of the religious elites, but the economic system that allowed them to maintain power and control over the people. Jesus' ministry was one of radical inclusion. In other words, meaning that everybody eats. It was not one that blamed people for their own poverty, simply telling them to pull themselves up by their own bootstraps, forgetting that most of the world doesn't have boots to wear. It was not one that sought to pit impoverished groups against each other. It wasn't one that used fear to convert individuals to the way. Rather, Jesus' movement was not one that sought to line his own pockets, charging people for their healing, charging people for their deliverance, charging people for their wholeness. His movement was not one that sought to throw spare change at people in need of actual change. His ministry was not one that sought to make money off of people in compromised situations. Church, our nation, our world, and even our faith tradition has at times forgotten what our Lord Jesus Christ's ministry was truly about. It's difficult to say you're a Christian on one hand, but deny literally healed people, deny people access to affordable quality health care on the other, when the one you say you serve literally healed people from physical and mental anguish free of charge. It's difficult to say that you're against fair and livable wages when the one we serve, Jesus the Christ, told stories about paying people what we owe them. It's hard to square up the fact that you don't want people to have access to the ballot box when Jesus literally died so that we might have access to the liberty of life. This morning, our scripture lesson lets us know that the power of the resurrection has implications not only for how we live individually, but how we operate collectively. Knowing the economic practices and behaviors of the early church, the 21st century church should be on the front line, standing with people and movements that bring our current economy in line with the economy of the kingdom of God, one rooted in love and equity. The resurrection story has power, and if we let it, it will transform how we think, not only going to heaven, but about how we think about economy, policies, and who is to be cared for in them. The resurrection story, if you leave with nothing else from today's sermon, take this with you. As believers in Christ's life, death, and resurrection, we have that same power to speak and fight for life in every space, place, and environment we find ourselves that brings harm to us or the least of these in the kingdom of God. As such, we need to ensure that everybody, from the well-polished to the unpolished, the educated to the uneducated, the professional to the blue-collar, the saved and the unsaved, eats. As mentioned last Sunday, I love the Gospel of Luke and its counterpart Acts because of the emphasis on inclusion and the power of the Holy Spirit. Lest we jump ahead to Pentecost, it is important to note that during the 50 days between Christ's resurrection and ascension, the Holy Spirit had not fallen on the people, yet miracles, signs, and wonders were still being performed. The work had not finished, but rather was just ramping up. That's good news for someone this morning, because you thought just because you had come to the end of your rope that there was no more strength left to fight. You thought that just because you had exhausted all of your options and strategies that there was nowhere else to go. But won't you tell someone in the chat or someone in your home that I'm just getting started. I'm just warming up. I'm just at the beginning. I'm just getting inspired. So in knowing this, we must recognize that the lectionary somewhat jumps ahead of itself. Nevertheless, this message points us to the power the resurrection story had over those who both told it and those who heard it. As we see throughout the book of Acts, the telling of this resurrection story will have the apostles at odds with the religious powers, just as Jesus' ministry had him at odds with them. It will have them flogged, beaten, thrown in jail, and ostracized. But I wonder if there's anyone out there in the virtual world who knows when you take a stand for truth, for love, and for equity, the end results always outweigh the consequences. Yeah, you might try to do harm to me, but my children will be set up for something better. You might try to demean me, but the door will be open wider for those coming after me. You might try to dismiss me, but those coming after me will have more power because of it. I thank God for the ancestors who sacrificed knowing that they might not see the winds, but that their children and their children's children, that their people, that their community would see them. So our text states that whole congregation of believers were united as one heart and one mind. It's important to recognize this fact early on. There was communal trust and understanding among the people that moved them to be able to participate in what we today would call collective cooperative economics. Cooperative economics is defined as people-centered enterprises owned, controlled, and run by and for their members to realize their economic, social, and cultural needs. It means that the people come together on one accord to address how they can create solutions for a better existence and future. The community of our text engages in this practice and can do so because they are all of one heart and one mind. Isn't it a beautiful thing when the people of God get on one accord? Is it not a blessing when the saints set aside their petty differences and work together for the glory of God and the good of their own lives? This is what was taking place in the early church, and if the truth be told, we've got to get back to this. We need not allow the isms of this life and age to keep us from being on one accord in pursuit of the will of God and God's kingdom. Verse 33 says that the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them. This means that they spoke not only with a boldness, but an assurance that brought others to the faith. Can we talk about this for a minute? This is a major challenge for the 21st century church today. We lack the boldness of the early church witnesses because we have allowed others to co-opt the narrative. We can't allow white supremacists or other groups who by their very actions are anti-Christian steal the power and privilege of the resurrection story. We have to reclaim the truth of the narrative and share it with the people in such a way that it, by itself and without coercion, brings them into the fold. Gone are the days of beating people over the head with the Bible, shaming people into the faith, or using ungodly means to justify the ends. Gone are the days when we could get away with those things. Rather, we must be real about what the resurrection represents in one's own life. Talk about how it means much more than an empty grave nearly 2,000 years ago. Talk about how it means that no longer does death or death-dealing situations, circumstances, or predicaments have power over me. No longer do dark days have the final say. No longer do people get to define who I am. No longer do the powers that be get to decide my life for me. No longer am I left out of healing, deliverance, and transformation. No longer do I have to live my life in fear because the Lord is my light and my salvation. No longer do I have to live in lack because the Lord is my shepherd. Tell them the story of what the resurrection means to you. And if you're still trying to figure it out, join us on Wednesday night Bible study to discuss it in a non-judgmental environment. Verse 34 and 35 says, there was not a needy person among them. For as many owned lands and houses, sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed as any had need. Can you imagine a world where there was no homelessness? Can you imagine a world where in the social safety net was thoroughly funded so that no one at the bottom had to live below the poverty line? Could you imagine a world wherein we brought our tithes and offerings into the church, not for our own bank accounts or simply to pay bills, but to use those funds to help alleviate the strain of debt? Could you imagine a world wherein everyone had access to clean water, quality food, a good paying job, benefits, and access to quality health care? Could you imagine a world wherein systems were put in place to uplift the oppressed rather than tax, dismiss, or further burden the oppressed? Could you imagine a world wherein the families in Africa, India, and South America and the Global South had access to the necessary capital to start businesses leading to self-sufficiency? Could you imagine a world wherein corporations and billionaires paid their fair share of taxes? The verse says that it was distributed as everyone had need. The problem is, today, we have too few who want too much. And those of us at the bottom are settling for the breadcrumbs when the table is overflowing with biscuits, gravy, ham, collard greens, mac and cheese, potato salad, turkey, chicken, pot roast, yams, and so much more. This idea of none lacking and distribution according to need has yet to make it into our economic imagination, because we live from a theology of scarcity, somehow forgetting that the God over the economy has more than enough to supply. We're taught to operate from a theology of scarcity because it allows the powers that be to control the type of lives we have. There's no need for over half of the discretionary budget to go towards military spending and then into the hands of already wealthy contractors. There is no reason that billionaires should have been able to have made nearly $931 billion during a pandemic that took the lives of nearly 2 million people globally. Now, while I'm not the best at math, something just doesn't sit right with me on that one. It's not that there's not enough money in the world. It is how and on what is being spent on. The early church operated in a way that countered the economy of Rome. It focused on the people, because when people, specifically those on the margins, the underserved, the underrepresented, the disenfranchised, the left out, are doing better, the economy does better. As such, we too should be on the front lines in efforts that lead us into better, more inclusive, and holistic approaches. This morning, we need to know that the resurrection story has so much power beyond our individual salvation. There has been and will always be a communal aspect to the salvific work of Christ Jesus in our lives and community. We must continue to tell our story about the resurrection, knowing that it has the power to transform, deliver, and bring in. The early church realized this, and through their efforts along with the Holy Spirit, none went lacking. When everyone eats, deliverance is made possible. When everyone eats, people are empowered to live lives of service and productivity. When everyone eats, healing is made available to the most vulnerable. When everyone eats, salvation is communal. When everybody eats, wholeness is possible. When everybody eats, wholeness is possible. When everybody eats, wholeness is possible. When everybody eats, communities are safer. When everybody eats, crime rates go down. When everybody eats, support systems are repaired. When everybody eats, education is not just a one-sided thing, but the community engages it. When everybody eats, the resurrection story's power is revealed. Therefore, let us make it our duty and our mission to ensure that everybody eats. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen and amen. This morning, maybe you are unaware of the fact and the notion that Christ did not just come to save our souls, but to make the environments in which we live better than they are. Christ's liberating power was not only so that we could get to heaven, but it was to liberate the chains from the isms, to liberate us from poverty, to liberate us from self-centeredness, to liberate us from greed and control, to liberate us from ourselves in so many ways. And so this morning, we offer unto you the opportunity to have a relationship with this liberating Lord, this sovereign Savior, this redeeming Lord. We offer the opportunity to have a relationship with them, to learn more, to know more, and become one of those on the front lines fighting to ensure that the power of the resurrection story is not just stuffed back in the grave, but that it makes its way to every aspect of our lives. The second call is for anyone looking for a church home. Being a part of the community of faith, as in this text, means that we have to share what we have with one another. And I know of no better place to be and share those resources than at Turner's Chapel African Methodist Episcopal Church in High Point, North Carolina. And the last call is anyone seeking prayer. Simply drop your name in the chat, drop your prayer concern in the chat, or drop it in the inbox, and we'll be sure to lift you up in prayer and pray with you. Pray with you on our Monday morning prayer call. Amen. Let us pray. To the God of abundance, we come now saying thank you. God, we thank you that you, when you created the world and the universe and so much more, you did not create from a sense of lack, but you created from a sense of abundance. You created knowing that you had more than enough, and it reminds us that we are more than enough. It reminds us, dear God, that we do not live in scarcity, that we should not have a mentality of scarcity, but rather we should have a mindset of abundance, knowing that the one who gives us life provides for us day in, day out, night after night, morning by morning, new mercies we see. So God, for that we say thank you. We thank you for your power and your presence in our lives, ensuring that no matter what goes on, God, you provide for us. And not only do you provide for us, but you provide for those around us. And you call us to share in those blessings with our neighbors. Great and awesome God, we ask right now that you forgive us of the times when we have not loved our neighbors, both systemically and on an individual level. God, we repent of systemic sins, corporate sins, as well as those on our individual level, asking that by your blood and by your presence in our lives, you would strengthen and renew us and guide us in the way that is pleasing unto you. Guide us in the way that shows your light and your liberating spirit. We ask, dear God, now, lifting up to you the sick and the shut-in in our midst, as well as those throughout the world, those dealing with COVID-19, God, those who are dealing with reactions from the vaccine, we pray that you would be with them. Those battling chronic illness, dear God, we pray that you would comfort them. God, we pray right now for nurses and CNAs and janitorial staffs and medical providers and nursing staffs all across this world who are enduring burnout even now. Praying that you would give them hope, give them rest, give them peace and renewal. Let them know that they are appreciated. Father God, we pray for those in the educational field, God, who are having to teach either in hybrid modes or all virtually, and are dealing with the challenges of the system. The prayer, God, is that you would provide for them. Move the hearts and the minds of those that are making leadership decisions, that are making decisions that affect those on the ground. That God, you would touch them in such a way that they would know the power of investing early on rather than having to deal with the consequences later on. God, we ask right now and pray for those families that are going through bereavement. God, we pray for our own, but Shaquan Moore and his family on today. praying that you would comfort and keep them in the loss of his great-grandmother. Praying for the Powell family, dear God, on today. Praying, dear Lord, for the family, the fans of DMX, and countless others, dear God, this week who lost their lives. Countless others, dear God, who went on to be with you in glory. We pray right now that you would comfort them. Wrap your loving arms around them. Remind them that your word says that you will comfort those who are in mourning. God, we can testify to it because you've done it for us. So we pray that you continuously do it for them. God, we pray in advance for these annual conferences that are coming up in the Second Episcopal District. We pray that you would guide them and that they would be pleasing in your sight. That you would order each conference according to your will and your way. God, prepare the hearts and the minds of your people to receive the insight, the sermons, the songs, all of the things that the annual conference season entails. God, we thank you in advance. We thank you in advance for the joy of the resurrection, of how it transforms our thinking and our insight. And it draws us into closer relationship with you and closer alignment with your kingdom. Guide us in the work of the resurrection as we celebrate this Easter season, looking forward to Pentecost. But help us to do the work of your kingdom. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior and our Lord and our resurrected Redeemer, in his name and in his power we do pray. Amen and amen. Amen. We again thank you for worshiping with us this morning and truly pray that this service has been a blessing unto you and your household. And we also would like you to lift up Sister Andrea's father, who is ill at this moment and has undergone surgery. Pray for him and pray for their family as he recovers and is restored to full health. We again thank you for worshiping with us and ask that you would go and share the page, share the message, share the ministry with family and friends. Again, let us know where you're viewing from, and we look forward to hopefully seeing you in our future services and future events that we'll have throughout this month and the months and days to come. Amen. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Together. enjoy the remainder of your week.